And the champion is Bedlam in the ring now. Windham just used a chair on Sting. Tommy Young is dazed. James J. Dillon dazed, but both men now trying to shake it loose. Can the Stinger shake? I ain't believing what we're seeing here. Don't let this happen. Big John Ayers in there.
Well, he went charging in to stop the referee. He stopped the count and pulls Windham off.
Hey, he's Big John is 6 feet five, 270 pounds. We got a winner by disqualification. We got a winner by disqualification. James J. Dillon is incensed at John Ayers. Look at Ayers, he's got James J. Dillon up.
World Championship Wrestling, bringing you great wrestling action sanctioned by the NWA, the National Wrestling Alliance.
We're the top athletes in the world of wrestling are. Hi, everybody. Tony Schiavone, David Crockett, and Jim Ross ringside on Superstation TBS for World Championship Wrestling. 1 week ago tonight, a change. New World Tag Team Champions. The Midnight Express, Jim Cornette's Midnight Express, defeated Tully Blanchard, Arn Anderson in Philadelphia to become World Tag Team Champions. We will see the new World Tag Team Champions a little bit later on in the program. And like we promised you last week, we will have right here, the challenge has been accepted. Ron Simmons goes up against Kevin Sullivan, David Crockett, and the dog collar match. You have some special interviews also.
That's right. I have a special interview with the World Tag Team Champions. Also, Barry Windham, United States Heavyweight Champion, about what happened last week, right? Then we're going to have also Kevin Sullivan. We'll be talking to him. And then Paul Jones and the Assassins.
You know, Paul Jones and the Assassins, Ivan Koloff, we've all seen that situation. Ivan Koloff, not a man to back down from anything. I know we'll try to talk to Ivan Koloff a little bit later on today.
We certainly will. You know, fans, controversy surrounds the NWA. We have a lot of colorful figures here, and they're colorful figures, of course, in the world of sports. Brian Bosworth's got a book out now, of course, called The Boz, and he writes about his life. And there's on page 28, it's a very interesting passage here. One paragraph, I'd like to read from that very quickly. And then there's this pro wrestler, Sting, whose hair is exactly like mine. Tells people it's his own idea. I should get a percentage of his gate. Well, Boz is one fellow Oklahoma football fan to another. We have the original right here. The Stinger had the haircut before you, my friend. And if you think that you're a better athlete than this young man, well, then perhaps you should contact Jim Crockett Promotions. I know you're watching, Boz. Have a great season with the Seahawks. And let the wrestling to be left to the Stinger. And he will be here live today.
Along, right, of course, with Barry Windham, the U.S. Heavyweight Champion, who we'll see a little bit later on. So it's a great program here today. Let's go to the ring for our first event.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the City of the Angels,
Tony, would like to remind the fans that tonight we expect a record-setting crowd in Charleston, South Carolina. I understand tonight, earlier this week, we're in Columbia, South Carolina. The fans, I know many fans anticipating the big event tonight in Charleston. It's going to be a great setting outdoors, I understand.
That's fans at the Johnson Hagwood Stadium. That's where the Citadel Bulldogs play their football games. It's the first time there for the NWA, and it's going to be certainly the biggest night ever down in a gorgeous city, Charleston, South Carolina. All right, the Fantastics in this event going up against Mike Jackson and Eddie Sweat, and we're taking a look at Bobby Fulton against Mike Jackson. Now, the situation, we have new World Tag Team Champions. There's no doubt the Fantastics feel that they are in line for a shot at those World Tag Team titles.
I think you see the tag team action here today on this program really intensify as the tag teams really want to shine here on national television as promoters from the NWA around the country looking at the great tag teams in preparation for negotiation with Jim Cornette's Midnight Express and the World Tag Team Championship. As David Crockett mentioned, he'll be talking to the Road Warriors here today. They certainly have those goals in mind as well. Great quickness there. This match will be one of the quickest matches that we'll see in this entire program.
to the other side. A reversal from Jackson. A high backdrop. As you see, Rogers landed on his feet with a dropkick down on Mike Jackson. Goes right after the arm once again. Athletic ability is what it's all about in the NWA, the Major League of Professional Wrestling. And Jim, you have the one-on-one confrontation or the tag team confrontations like none other. And now the Jim Cornette. Oh, look at that move. First time we've seen that.
Yeah, nice move there by Bobby Fulton. And, of course, the NWA all kicked it off in 1905. And you can talk about the great champions, the Luthes, the Carl Gotch, the Hackenschmidts, the Funks, the Briscoes, Big Thunder, Gene Kaninsky, all the great champions, Dusty Rhodes, three-time champion. But perhaps the greatest champion of them all, without any exaggeration, will be here with David Crockett in just a few moments. I'm speaking specifically, of course, of Nature Boy Ric Flair.
And that'll be coming up right after this match. All right. Fulton holding on to Eddie Sweat and going to the arm. We have seen some great battles in the past between the Midnight Express and the Fantastics. There is no doubt, and you fans know this, when they go into the ring after the World Tag Team title, it's nothing new. Two teams that are very familiar with each other's style, and I think really give fans an exciting match as far as tag teams are concerned.
We will have a match that will be aired on the NWA main event hotline that the fans, of course, can call in on our 900 number to hear with the Fantastics and the Midnight Express, one of the greatest matches that we have had in a long, long time on the NWA hotline. But I often wonder what type of team it will take to defeat the Midnight Express. A quick team, an explosive team like the Fantastics, or the big, powerful team like the Road Warriors. In any event, this move is effective against any kind of opponent.
It's the rocket launcher, and your winner's the Fantastics. It's going to take a team, Jim Ross, that has to be at the very top of their game when they face the Midnight Express. Why? Because right now, they really have the lock on being the most dominant team in professional wrestling, holding two titles at one time.
Never before in the history of the NWA has that occurred, and you also have to do something to neutralize Jim Cornette. And ladies and gentlemen, we see the Fantastics put the finishing touches and win this one. David Crockett will be standing by with Chicago Bears number one draft choice favorite wrestler, Ric Flair. He'll be out here, I understand, in just a moment.
All right, David.
Ladies and gentlemen, the World Heavyweight Champion. You know what that means? You're at the top of your profession. The man, Ric Flair. Everyone has said that he is the greatest heavyweight champion ever. Dusty Rhodes even says that. To be the man, you have to beat the man. And here's the man, Ric Flair, World Heavyweight Champion.
You know, David Crockett, there are times in my life when even Ric Flair has to look in the mirror and say, "Ooh, mirror, mirror on the wall. Who is the fairest of them all?" And for 7 years, that mirror has looked back at me and said, "Why, Nature Boy, it's you. Who else? You are the National Wrestling Alliance World's Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. And big man, you have styled and profiled your way from one end of this world to the other. And right here today, Atlanta, Georgia, looking better than ever before, I am telling the American public, I'm telling wrestling fans worldwide, Lex Luger is not the answer. The answer is yours truly, the incumbent, Nature Boy Ric Flair, your world's heavyweight champion, whether you like it or not. We have talked about Luger being the most awesome man alive physically, but the bottom line, Big Lex, is to be the man. You gotta beat the man, baby. And right now, I am the man.
That he is. He's a world heavyweight champion, Ric Flair. When we come back, the Russian Assassins. brings the two big Russian assassins, one and two, into the ring against Keith Steinborn and Gary Royal. And I don't think we ever expected to see battles between men from the Soviet Union like we have, but no doubt Ivan Koloff, certainly at the hands of the Russian assassins, what I guess, lack of a better term, Jimmy, you were down at ringside during our special just last week. He was absolutely destroyed by two men down there.
He certainly was. They really had their sights set on the great veteran, the proud athlete, that man right there, Paul Jones, orchestrating the whole situation, one of the most devious, underhanded men. I wouldn't trust him whatsoever. But what he has done, he has two big masked men that have taken a great opportunity against Ivan Koloff. And, of course, we hope that Ivan Koloff will be talking with Ivan a little bit later here in the program. That's a great team move. These guys are getting better every week.
Not only did number two whip number one to the corner, but also number one helped his own cause by jumping into Keith Steinborn, and now levels him with an elbow. We talked a lot about Russian assassin number one, about the agility for the big man. We haven't seen that much of Russian assassin number two. As a matter of fact, the only thing we have seen here on the Super Stage is the run-in when he ran in on Ivan Koloff. So it's really our first look at him in the ring in a match.
He's a very agile big man, 6'4". Looks to be the 280-pound range, and he moves with the same cat-like quickness that the Russian assassin number one moves in. And we have also seen, Tony, and we have heard that these men, of course, are just in the same mold that Paul Jones, and their tactics, we often wonder what's in that mask. We know that there's a motionless face, so we almost can perceive there. But you almost have to wonder sometimes what they would do when the chips really got down to it in regard to loading that mask. We have heard that rumor. Jones has refuted that, of course.
All right, we'll see what happens. Sending Steinborn in, and there is a forearm shot. Here comes number one. He comes off from the other side, and all the 300-plus pound frame on the back of Keith Steinborn. And now, well, we're going to take a look at it firsthand. You see in the right of your screen, you can't see it from here, but he reached towards Paul Jones, picked up something, put it in the mask, apparently, and now the headbutt.
Totally unnecessary. They had Steinborn defeated. And right there, keep an eye on him, fans, right there. They're turning away from the camera, so we can't get a good shot of it. But there was something in the mask of that man, Jones. We asked him specifically about it. He's denied it. And David Crockett's going to be talking with him in just a moment. Perhaps David could speak with him about that. But right here, Tony, here's where the damage was done.
You wonder why men the caliber of the Russian assassins, athletes like they are, and it's apparent, would resort to something like that. The answer is obvious. That man in your screen right there, number one, Paul Jones. He wants victims. And let's go down to David Crockett at ringside.
All right, here they are, the Russian assassins and Paul Jones. Paul?
You know something, David? I feel one way about Ivan Koloff, and this big Russian here has something to say about Ivan Koloff on behalf of the great country of Russia.
Ivan Koloff. We do Rocky, Nikita Koloff, we do Rocky, Ivan Koloff, the epizode in нашу страну, Nikita, нет советский одет, я лучше хочу советский одет.
And let me say something else. One of y'all were talking earlier about the boss. Well, do you think his teammates respect him because he's a great joke teller in the locker room? No! It's because he produces out on the field. He gets the job done. And Ivan Koloff, that's one thing that you didn't do for number one, Paul Jones. And you're not going to go off and wrestle on your own and talk to people and tell them what a bad person I was. You're not going to wrestle at all, Ivan Koloff. And anybody that wants to befriend Ivan Koloff, you're going to pay the same price. And I don't think anybody will stick with you very long, Koloff, because you won't get the job done for them either.
All right, Paul Jones. Paul Jones, you've got Nikita Koloff, right? And Ivan Koloff together. You got to watch out for that.
I'm not worried with these two big Russians here. These two big Russians here, they know exactly the way I think and what I want, and they'll get the job done, and that goes for anybody.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, more action to come right after this.
Back with Brad Armstrong going up against Agent Steel in this event on World Championship Wrestling. Tony Schiavone, and Jim Ross. We're going to take a look at a fine athlete, Brad Armstrong. Singles are tag team. You know, I know fans say, hey, you've been talking well about Brad Armstrong for the last couple of weeks. I think what we say about Brad Armstrong really does a lot for him because we believe that he is a great athlete. But I think the fans really saw it on the Superstation last Wednesday, what type of athlete, what type of determination this young man has. It was an awesome match. You were down at ringside. One of the best world television title matches I had ever seen.
It's the best I'd ever seen, Tony. I'll guarantee you. Our hats off both to Mike Rotunda and to Brad Armstrong for competing in such a tremendous contest. As Tony Schiavone mentioned last Wednesday night, the Clash of Champions 3. And I tell you, I believe in Brad Armstrong. He is a great athlete. And we just expect great things for this fine young man as the course of 1988 continues.
Not many people can say they have gone the distance with a guy like Mike Rotunda. Of course, Dr. Death is one of them. With Brad Armstrong coming in, and Brad had not wrestled Rotunda that often. The more you wrestle a guy, of course, the better you get at being able to defeat him. But now he goes in against Mike Rotunda, basically maybe one of the first couple of times he's ever faced him, and goes the limit with him. And there was a time where we thought that maybe Brad could not hang on, but athletic ability prevailed and the man stayed in there, and it was quite a gutsy performance.
Certainly was. Tony, I want to take this opportunity to send our best wishes and condolences from the National Wrestling Alliance to the family of Leroy McGurk, longtime promoter for the NWA. He had a big hand in molding the NWA in its early years in the 1930s and the 1940s. Leroy passed away last Friday in Tulsa, Oklahoma at 78 years of age. And of course, our heartfelt wishes are to his family and his widow, Dorothy.
All right. We certainly passed that along to the McGurk family. Also, passed a note that Pete Hutchinson, a fan who has watched World Championship Wrestling for many years of Flintstone, Georgia, passed away this past week, and our condolences to his family. Brad Armstrong still hooking onto the arm of Agent Steel. Armstrong has a lot of confidence to go with that ability, and it takes a lot of confidence to get in the ring on Nationwide TV. You know, it's something about Nationwide TV, like we were last Wednesday night, with a large nationwide audience of millions of people that sometimes can either bring out the best or the worst in a wrestler. Obviously, with Brad Armstrong, it's the best.
Armstrong, what a drop kick. This kick can really drop kick you. Armstrong right in the face of Agent Steel, and Brad Armstrong like a cat ready to pounce on its prey. Side rushing leg sweep, and this kid is getting hot right now, fans. Brad Armstrong, with your support, I'll tell you, he is getting better and better each and every week. And a great side rushing leg sweep there. Brad Armstrong is getting hot, Tony, just at the right time.
There's no doubt what happened last Wednesday night right here on the Superstation. A lot for his confidence, if nothing else. Brad Armstrong with another great win. We'll be seeing more great things from Brad Armstrong in the weeks to come.
Right now, he looks cool and calm. But when he puts his wrestling gear on and gets in that ring, the Russian Nightmare Nikita Koloff, you've got to watch out for him.
You got to watch out for Paul Jones. That's who you have to watch out for. And the Russian Assassin. Pushyanovista. You see, Paul Jones, he's a man with, how do you say, a whooping mind, Paul Jones. You seem to find a way to get big, powerful men. A few months ago, I was there when you hit the road, Williams. You see, Animal, he has become close friend of Nikita Koloff. And I see the scar on Animal eye. That could have been a scar on the face of Nikita Koloff. You see, Paul Jones, but you don't stop, Paul Jones. You see, I give you a lot of credit. You have a way to find big, powerful men. But don't forget one thing about Nikita Koloff. For me, there is no law, and if I have to, I can be bad, and the people know it.
That's right, he can be bad, real bad. Now let's go to the ring for another bad man, Dr. Death, Steve Williams.
All right, David, the doc, all 275 pounds of him, going up against the big man himself, Curtis Thompson, but Doc is ready to fight. Goes quickly with a side headlock on Thompson. 275.5 solid pounds. Great offensive lineman, great amateur background. We've said it all before, but the man, when he really wants to turn it on, Jim Ross, in the ring, can really do it.
Well, he's a great one and great intensity. Dr. Death Steve Williams, we've seen him team recently here on the Superstation with Brad Armstrong. We saw him on our special broadcast from Albany, Georgia, Clash of Champions 3. And of course, Dr. Death was with Brad Arm, was with Nikita Koloff at that time. And Doc has had various partners, all have been very effective partners. He's a man that is easy to team with because his style is very basic. He comes right at you. He's not real fancy. He comes right at you. And that is, like I said, he's very basic.
I don't think he had that move planned. Curtis Thompson just kind of jumped up there and he kind of improvised right there. Went right down with him, and Thompson very, very slow getting up. And there's the DDT. We are seeing each and every week from Steve Williams different moves, showing us his ability in the ring professionally, different moves each and every week. That DDT is something new for the Doc.
Doc very adamant that the next time he wrestles Mike Rotunda, he wants a longer than a 20-minute time limit, preferably a 60-minute time limit for Dr. Death. We know that Rotunda is in great condition and would not have any trouble going 60 minutes, but Doc feels like he would have his best opportunity to defeat Mike Rotunda if there were a 60-minute time limit. Doc has felt like that Rotunda has being such a great wrestler, can really manipulate the time where you have to beat him. He doesn't have to beat you as a champion.
And with Kevin Sullivan at ringside, it's hard to think what Doc would have to go up against in, let's say, a 60-minute time limit. Sullivan noted to take up anything, including cinder blocks, to try to hurt somebody. Speaking of Kevin Sullivan, a dog collar match. Kevin Sullivan and Ron Simmons still to come in this program. There's your three count from the Oklahoma Stampede, and the Doc is a winner once again, one of the biggest, meanest men in wrestling. Speaking of that, David Crockett will be talking to a few in just a minute, Jim.
He certainly will. The Road Warrior standing by here with David Crockett. But look at this intensity and the impact from Dr. Death Steve Williams. He is an animal, no doubt about it, Dr. Death Steve Williams. And when you talk about animals and guys that want their way, there's some bad men standing by with David Crockett.
Oh, that's right, they are animals. They're the Legion of Doom, the Road Warriors. Hawk, an animal. Listen, I was talking to Jim Cornette, and Jim Cornette says, since they are the World Tag Team Champions, you men are the next in line.
David Crockett, what Jim Cornette's got is a bad case of diarrhea of the mouth. Nobody dictates us what we're next in line for. We dictate our own destiny, and our destiny right now is to be the World Tag Team Champions. We run the powers of pain out. Tully and I, they lost the belts. We said we're the next ones in line for titles, and that's what we're going to do. No matter when it comes up, we're taking that world belts, and if you don't like it, we don't care.
Tell them, Hawk. Hey, it's no secret that I'm a few bricks short of a full load, but I got just enough bricks to know one thing, and that nobody besides us deserves a title shot more than us. We're the LOD. We stand at the top, all alone, by ourselves, looking down at everybody else, and looking way down, and going, hey, it's a big hill to climb, and we're on top to stay. Now, we are the motor and the machine. We are the brawn, and here's the brain. Ladies and gentlemen, if you will, my sick-headed, demented, and slightly twisted manager, Precious Ball.
You know, David, a lot of people got to be wondering what the truth is. So it all comes down to, what is truth? Is truth something you believe, or is it something that somebody tells you? For us, it's something we believe. We're the baddest cats walking this earth, and we'll do anything, anything to win a match. Think about that, Jim Cornette. We'll do anything.
We snack on danger, we dine on death, and dead men don't make money.
All right, Jim Cornette, Midnight Express, watch out, because they're coming. Coming your way right after this, more action with Ivan Koloff.
It's the Russian Bear, Ivan Koloff, against Jerry Price, and Koloff immediately goes to work on Price. You may notice that Koloff has that head taped up. It was back on September 7th, right here on the Superstation, that Ivan Koloff viciously attacked. Good to see him back, because the way that he took punishment, you wondered if a man could really come back from something like that.
That was 10 days ago, Tony, and Ivan Koloff is a day he will never forget on September the 7th. One thing about it, He's got some scores to settle with some of his comrades, and very specifically as well, Paul Jones. But Koloff obviously has not changed his style. Man. Well, that's good.
You know, maybe Ivan does have to approach it like this, and I'll tell you why, Jim. He is a man right now alone. He has no friends. There is nobody that I can point to right now that would say that they would really take up sides with Ivan Koloff.
Well, you're right, and Koloff right here is acting, I tell you what, as if he knows that quite well, and the fact that he's going to take care of business himself. And that's what he's doing certainly right here with Jerry Price. Don't forget, fans, tomorrow night, big NWA card tomorrow night in Roanoke, Virginia, and this Friday night in Frederick, Maryland. Big card there.
At the community college right there, Jim Ross.
Of course, the NWA back in Washington, D.C. at the D.C. Army 1 week from tonight. And, of course, the next big event in the Omni is going to be on Sunday night, September 25th. And, of course, fans, we're going to be talking more and more each and every week about the big event. Latter part of October, downtown New Orleans, Louisiana, Municipal Auditorium.
It's going to be a great event. Ivan Koloff, we've said so many great things about Ivan Koloff, and they're all true. Former world heavyweight champion, world tag team champion. The man is one of the true greats in this sport. And he got there by his intensity and his dedication to his workout regimen. He's just an all-around athlete. You know, many people will say that Ivan Koloff, for many years, was one of the strongest, most powerful men in wrestling. And certainly he lived up to that.
His training regimen is certainly to be envied. And the great veteran is always a tremendous competitor. His accolades, with over 20 major championships to his credit, and very few wrestlers in the history of this long sport since the NWA came around in 1905 can boast that they have held 20 major titles. Ivan Koloff can certainly do that. And he is looking forward to a battle. And it will be like a war of Russia, so to speak, a civil war involving these great Russian athletes. And right now, Ivan is at a definite disadvantage because there's two big Russians and Paul Jones and only one Ivan Koloff.
That's right, the odds are really stacked against him, and now Koloff sets a foot in. Price is up against the ropes. Here comes Koloff. You know, every time you look at the Russian assassin wrestle, you see some of Ivan Koloff in it. You can't take that away from him, there's no doubt, but certainly he can try to destroy the Russian bear. He is up on the middle turnbuckle and the Russian sickle. That is a move that Ivan Koloff brought to this country.
There's been a lot of great athletes from Europe, great athletes from Germany and from Russia, but when you really compare records, that man right there is the yardstick that all great European wrestlers have been measured on. Ivan Koloff with a hard-fought victory here on the Superstation, Tony, as we take another look at the sickle. And Paul Jones and the Russians, even though Ivan Koloff may be undermanned as far as having the support, he will come at them with that great intensity that we know he has. And he's standing by now at ringside with our colleague David Crockett.
That he is, the ring general, the man, 20 world championships all over the world. You've done it. You're the man that Russia looks for. Now you have the Russian assassins coming after you.
I appreciate that, Crockett, but I don't come out here for compliments. I come out here to relay a message, not only all to the people of America, but directed at you assassins, and especially you, Paul Jones. You know we're all accountable for our actions in this world, throughout the world, whether they are good or they are bad actions. And I've not always done everything according to the book or always right, but I hold myself accountable for this. And in the past, you see, I am ashamed of some of the things that I have done. But I don't ask for any forgiveness, or I don't ask for any help, because when Paul Jones came to me and we made an alliance, he asked me not to go out and get the most gentle of us of a team, the most nice, no, just the opposite. He asked me to go out and get the most vicious, the rottenest, the lowest, the most destructive, the most greedy two I could find. Yes, I feel responsible for my actions, bringing them here to America. Yes, I created the situation, and I will take care of the situation. You see, Paul Jones, you are a very selfish man. You don't have to go out and capture the things that you want out of life the way that you do. But you choose to. You are in a free country here. You got to be able to choose between how you get it. You don't have to take it at the suffering of other people. You say, I didn't get the job done.
No, because you wanted me to go out and break arms. You wanted me to hurt little wrestlers. But you see, that is my style. I am from all country, all country ways. And I cannot change my ways. All habits are hard to be broken. But you see, I don't think I'll ever change my way of wrestling, because that is the way I know how. But Paul Jones, you had the choice in pre-America, but you choose to slide in the gutter and come up behind somebody's back and hurt people to gain your advantage. Well, Paul Jones, you tell your assassins, and let this be a warning to you, whether you use that crop that you carry around, or you have the assassins take foreign objects out of their truck and put in their mask to use on the opponent, you will never have enough in here, Paul Jones, to deal with Ivan Koloff.
Truly a great man. We'll be back right after this. Like we said, there are new world...
Make a big deal. Ladies and gentlemen, I present the undisputed tag team champions of the world, Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan, the Midnight Express.
Have we had a dual NWA World and NWA U.S. Tag Team Championship team? Certainly, as you said, no other team has ever done that. And there's been some great tag teams in this sport, and there still are, without belts. We saw the Legion of Doom, the Road Warriors, a great dominant tag team. But you talk about a team being hot. The hottest team in all of wrestling, certainly it has to be Tag Team of the Year, no doubt, the Midnight Express.
You want to look at this? Look
a shoe in.
J.C. Wild, hold on.
Hold on those belts there, Jim. Maybe more than you can carry.
I got to find a wheelbarrow, a U-Haul, something. There's so much gold around
Let's
here.
Hire somebody to carry it around
We're
for you.
We're open up a jewelry store. Brother, let me tell you something right now. The Midnight Express champions of every state, province, country, and continent. The hottest tag team in wrestling. You talk about awards. Brother, Tag Team of the Year 1987, we're a shoe-in for 1988.
You think you got Manager of the Year locked up now, James?
I think I got Manager of the Year locked up. I'm pretty confident about that. Yes, I am. World Tag Team Champions twice. The longest reigning United States Tag Team Champions in history. The only team ever to hold a U.S. Tag Team title twice. The only team ever to hold a U.S. and the World Tag Team title at the same time. These guys are hot, brother. They're so hot, they're on fire. As a matter of fact, they got a fever. That's how hot they are. The Midnight Express, we finally proved it. That old Methuselah, J.J. Dillon, the 1988 poster boy for Alzheimer's disease, he has finally realized just what I've been saying all along. We got the proof right here, brother. We got the proof right here. World Tag Team Champions, U.S. Tag Team Champions. So they're going to make us give up the U.S. Tag Team title. That don't make no difference. We're going to give that up in a week or so. They'll put that up in the tournament because we got what we want. We knew what we wanted all along, and we achieved it. What do you want, Tony?
Well, you know, you just don't win a title and sit back and watch things happen. You know, now we saw the Legion of Doom, the Road Warriors out here. Now more than ever, men are going to come after you guys.
I saw the Road Warriors out here looking like a board of directors of a massage parlor with all that leather and all them spikes on. Let me tell you something. The only thing that looks funnier than the outfits and the face paint that the Road Warriors wear is that little pea head sitting on top of Paul Ellering's shoulders. He ought to grow him some hair. And I tell you what, Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan can do some things to the human body that'll grow some hair on your chest or any other place you in some need of it. I guarantee you that. Right now, this kid, he don't know where he's coming or going. He's so stupid. If it was raining chicken soup, he'd be out in the front yard with a fork. Look at him. He can't even stand up. The Midnight Express World Tag Team Champions, U.S. Tag Team Champions, the greatest combination in the history of professional wrestling.
I guess this makes you the greatest manager of all time, right?
Well, you know, Jim, since you come to mention that little point.
I know you want to talk about that.
Since you come to mention that little point, I don't care whether you're J.J. Dillon, whether you're Paul Ellering, whether you're Paul Jones, whether you're Kevin Sullivan, whether you're Gary Hart, I don't care whether you're the manager of Exxon Corporation or whatever. There's no manager ever in history guided his men to both the World Tag Team title and the U.S. Tag Team title. As you know right now, the World Tag Team title of the NWA is the most prestigious tag team belt in history, but to have the U.S. belts at the same time, that's unheard of, brother. That borders on ridiculous. We are so great, it ain't even funny.
You're a great leader of men. This is a political year. Yeah. Have you ever thought about running for election or anything, James?
You know, something I thought about lending my talents to being, you know, a political cause, but I figured that Bush and Quail sounds like a companion magazine to Field and Stream. I don't need to get involved in this, man. This ain't even a fun election. I'm going to wait till 92 when there's some interesting people going, and maybe I'll let one of them be my vice presidential candidate.
That's not a bad idea. It could be something to look forward to. Well, I wanted to ask you one thing. The Fantastics out here earlier, the Sheepherders have expressed an interest also in the World Tag Team titles, and we know that they're rough, they're tough, and you know that very well.
Look at beautiful Bobby. Let me tell you something about the Sheepherders, brother. They come from a country where there's 3 million people and 200 million sheep. And that means they're early risers, because you got to get up early to get the best looking sheep. But they are not the best tag team in professional wrestling. The Midnight Express are. Same thing with the Fantastics. We beat them like red-headed stepchildren. You know something, Tully Blanchard and Arn Anderson, I will have to say, they were tough, brother, but they weren't tough for long. It took a good team to beat them, but it didn't take them long. But they were our competition, and we proved they thought they were unbeatable. Everybody else thought they were unbeatable, but we beat them. Arn Anderson, of course, he still has the title of the National Dom DeLuise Lookalike Champion, so that's okay for him. But, brother, we destroyed the myth and destroyed the legend. We are the greatest. Like I've been telling you all along, you wouldn't listen to me. Now we see who knows what they're talking about. This is unheard of, the championships that we possess, and we're going to talk some about it here in just a minute. As soon as they strip that boy's face off that canvas so they can continue on with the matches here.
Well, I'll tell you what, we have seen a
I'll certainly
be glad to. We've seen a devastating display of wrestling ability by the Midnight Express, a new World Tag Team Champions. Jim Cornette is right. Yes, they do indeed hold all the gold here, ladies and gentlemen. And we'll take another look at the closing moments of that contest, Tony. Look at this, Tony. Great move. Double team move. We'll be going to the Spam Slam in just a moment, ladies and gentlemen. But there's some Spam Slam right there, I'll tell you, all over the canvas. All right.
Got our Spam Slam of the week.
Spam Slam is brought to you by Hormel, makers of Spam and other grocery products.
One of the most awesome moves in professional wrestling, the double team by the Road Warriors and the clothesline off of the top. Hawk coming off, Animal holding the man down, and the gigantic flip. The Road Warriors with our Spam Slam of the week.
Spam Slam is brought to you by Hormel, makers of Spam and other grocery products.
All right, when you're hot, you're hot. Jim Cornette and the Midnight Express definitely are.
You know something? The Four Horsemen always said, the proof is in the pudding. Well, brother, the Midnight Express got about 40 pounds of gold pudding sitting on the desk right here today. Sweet Stan, I know you got to build a new trophy room in your house.
You know, week after week for the past year and a half, David and Crockett, Arn and Tully stood out here on TBS and expounded on the virtues of being a world champion. They talked about limousine rides, the finest hotels, champagne. But in the course of 10 short minutes, they went from white-on-white stretched wheelbase limousines to subcompacts at Dollar Rent-A-Car. They went from Dom Perignon champagne to generic beer at Harris Teeter. And they went from Marriotts and Hyatts to budget tails and Days Inns. You know why? Because that's stuff that make champions. Working hard, perseverance, and dedication do, and that's why we're the world champions, and that's why we're the greatest tag team in the world today.
Let me tell you something I always told everybody. I sat down and I told everybody the Midnight Express are the greatest tag team in the history of professional wrestling, and nobody ever believed me. Well, like we said, the proof is in the pudding, and we got the proof, and now even you, David, have to admit all along that we are the greatest that there's ever been.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we've got to go for the football college scoreboard right after this. More action.
Mike Justice and Terry Jones, the opponents for the Varsity Club.
You know, Jim, there's no doubt as we take a look at Mike Rotunda, the World Television Champion, that Steiner's been taking an awful lot of heat lately from the Games Master, Kevin Sullivan. And it really can't be because of the way he performs in the ring, because Steiner is one of the best in the world, but he's got that Varsity Club jacket.
He's also
on.
Got his jacket.
Yeah, and he comes in.
Look at him. He wants to leave. He's proud of his leather jacket. He wants to wear it. That's why he bought it. He may be a little nippy in the studio here today.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Steiner hammers away at Terry. Just look at the strength. He just muscled him up. That's just brute power right here. This man has got his... Oh, gosh! Have you ever seen a move like... I have never seen a move like that. Face first slam.
I want him to do it again. Oh, my goodness! Complete domination from Rick Steiner, and now he pulls up at the request of Sullivan and Mike Rotunda.
He's a walking highlight tape. I mean, he delivers some blows. He had a man beat in Rotunda. They're adamant. Look at Sullivan, like chastising him like he was a kid. He wanted Rotunda to get the pin. Look at Steiner, still wants to get in the camera shot. Steiner did the work, did the damage, but again, Rotunda gets the pin at Sullivan's encouragement.
All right, this butterfly suplex over the top was academic, as you can say. Your winners, the Varsity Club, along with Games Master Kevin Sullivan. We'll be back with more right after College Football Scoreboard. Last week on the station, after a couple of weeks of challenges, Gary Hart finally had someone accept, and his name is Ron Simmons. And coming up right after the break, we're going to see Ron Simmons and Kevin Sullivan in the dog collar match, Jim.
The big showdown is going to happen right here in the studio, and it's going to happen in just a few moments.
The moment is here on the Superstation. Kevin Sullivan, Ron Simmons in a dog collar match. Now, to win a dog collar match, you have to be able to answer the bell. In other words, if you're down for a 10 count,
you have to survive.
You got to survive. Right. Now, already, the man does not answer the bell. Already.
Gary Hart just slapped Ron Simmons right in the face. Sullivan did not strap the dog collar around his neck and lock it in, and he has taken the collar off, and you can see he's using the chain to lash Ron Simmons, and just, we're talking some brutal punishment right here in the Superstation in this dog collar challenge match.
Once again, premeditated actions from Gary Hart, and especially from Kevin Sullivan. Of course the chain is legal. He is getting lashed, strapped, whatever you want to say. He is getting bludgeoned with that chain.
But the main thing, Tony, is that he has taken the collar off his neck. That is the key point here, is that if Hart was putting it around his neck, Teddy Long, the referee, put it around Simmons' neck. And, of course, we know the message that man, Gary Hart, wants us to send out is to the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, because Rhodes is the man that they are looking at and putting this dog collar around his neck. This is a very physical and potentially, obviously, violent situation here. Sullivan going up to the top. Simmons has been hammered from one side of the ring to the other. But Simmons just nailed Sullivan with a gut shot, and Sullivan really felt it.
Fans really into it with him now, and Ron Simmons with a chain hooked on, going right after Kevin Sullivan, and he has really lost it right here. His temper is like we've never seen with Ron Simmons. He'll send him to the other side. The chain is off. It has come away from his neck. It is down on the floor now, and over the top goes Ron Simmons.
Simmons now, they're going to wrap that chain around him. Referee calling for the bell. They're trying to choke the life out of Ron Simmons right here. And there you see, there comes Al Perez.
He's being hanged right here.
They're trying to hang him right here on national television. Simmons and Sullivan. Wait a minute. Here comes the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, with a chair.
All right, Dusty is out. He's over there with Jim Ross, who's down with Ron Simmons.
Run. Hey, come on, man. What's the matter with you?
All right, fans, right here. This thing got completely out of hand.
Never. Get back from here, gentlemen. Come here, baby. We could get some help out of here.
The man, we don't know how long, Jim, but...
Let me tell you something. I know why you came out here, Kevin Sullivan. You came for me. Let me tell you something. You don't have to look for me no further. You don't have to look for me. I'm standing out here right now with Ron Simmons. If you want some of me, strap that around my neck. Around my neck, big man. And see how bad you can get. See how bad you are, Sullivan.
Well, I tell you what, a volatile situation here with the American Dream. And no doubt that Dusty Rhodes is the object of this dog collar showdown. And fans, we're going to get out of this segment. Dusty's going to take Ron back to the locker room. We'll be back right after this timeout. Well, fans, of course, a very volatile situation right here on the Super Station with a dog collar match. We saw Kevin Sullivan, the start, have trouble putting that on his neck.
Well, not only putting it on, I went back and looked at that dog collar, and something a little fishy. The next time we have a dog collar match, it'll be padlocked, and there won't be any hanky-panky. We'll have a dog collar, and nobody's going to slip out of it.
Okay, hey, Mr. Jim Crockett, the president of Jim Crockett.
This is a personal issue, and he's out here giving edicts of what's going to happen.
Padlock.
Well, that's a padlock that will end your career, Rhodes. They put a padlock on that. Just hand us another weapon. Jimmy Crockett, Crockett Promotions, isn't going to save you, brother. Mega Force is on its way, and your days are numbered.
You know, getting away now, fans. It'll be padlock from here on out, that dog collar. Let's go back to the ring. All right, it's going to be Barry Windham, the United States champion, and Randy Mulkey here on Superstation TBS. Again, remember, fans, tomorrow night in Roanoke, great NWA event. And in just a few days, NWA promoter Gary Juster has a couple of great events this Friday night in Frederick, Maryland, and 1 week from tonight at the D.C. Armory next to RFK Stadium, of course, in Washington, D.C. I remind you, fans in Washington, that you can take the Metro right to the door of the D.C. Armory.
Certainly
enjoy
can.
The wrestling.
Take the old Metro right to the front door, and right here's a man that has taken the big train to a very prestigious position in the National Wrestling Alliance, Barry Windham. Of course, under the managerial efforts of James J. Dillon, Windham, the United States heavyweight champion. We know that the Stinger would dearly love to walk out here someday with the United States Heavyweight Championship around his waist. But Barry Windham is going to do all he can, obviously, to prevent that situation. I personally think it's a great matchup of two phenomenal, young, exciting athletes. And we've seen some great battles, Tony. You and I have been at ringside along with Dave. We've seen some great battles between these two men. We saw one right here on Superstation TBS. Remember the date? September the 7th, 10 days ago.
10 days ago, that's right. Barry Windham and Sting. You know, and Jim, I think right now, James J. Dillon has been so successful as a manager, Randy Mulkey may have hurt his lower back for the rest of his life right there. James J. Dillon holding that U.S. title right there has been very successful. But now he does not have in his reign those World Tag Team belts. And this is the point, and we've said it so many times under the guise of James J. Dillon, where his men are so dangerous. Guys like Ric Flair and his challenges with Lex Luger, and guys like Barry Windham with Sting. It may be a dangerous time for Sting and Lex Luger, because anytime you think you got a man like James J. Dillon on the ropes, he fires back, he surprises you.
Well, James J. Dillon is the leader of the Four Horsemen. Let's don't just separate that and disassociate that. He is the man behind the plan. He is the brains behind that organization. And with great athletes, of course, like this man, Barry Windham, and how much better can you get? The world's heavyweight champion in the NWA. And we've talked about the great champions. We mentioned earlier the Funks and the Briscoes, the Gene Kaninskis, the Harley Race, Dusty Rhodes, and all the men that go back even farther, many of the great years, that Flair is the greatest of all time. So James J. Dillon certainly does not have a bare cupboard, as it were.
And, of course, Barry Windham. And what a direction his career has taken since coming under the guidance of James J. Dillon. We always knew that Barry Windham, well, he was a World Tag Team Champion until he turned on Lex Luger. And now, certainly, maybe a lot of people are you know, they argue about the point, is Barry Windham the greatest U.S. champion of all time? That's an argument right there, because there have been some great ones with Nikita Koloff, with a Magnum TA. But certainly right now, he is one of the most dominant U.S. champions in a long time.
I think we're in an era here right now where many of the fans might have a hard time disagreeing that we don't have the greatest champions in the NWA ever right now. Rotunda, the television title. Windham and the U.S. title. We talked about Nature Boy Ric Flair. And what else can you say about the Midnight Express? First team ever to hold both major tag team championships. And look at this great, this lariat. He's 6'6", 265 pounds from Sweetwater, Texas. Barry Windham is the unprecedented and the uncontested world or United States champion. And James J. Dillon is now standing by with David Crockett.
Ladies and gentlemen, there it is. The United States Heavyweight Championship belt. The man that holds it. Talking about Barry Windham and what a tough man he is. J.J. Dillon, what about your situation, though? The loss of the World Tag Team title.
Well, life has to go on. I first would like to say that Barry Windham, again, another very impressive victory here, defending the United States Heavyweight title. It's taken a new level of prestige since Mr. Windham has garnished the title. I'm besieged with phone calls from promoters all over the country. Just this week, I spoke with Don Owens out in Portland, Oregon. Of course, Don Owens is the dean of wrestling promoters, not only on the West Coast, but all across this country. His name is synonymous with the best of professional wrestling because it has the banner of NWA above the door. And I know he's very proud of the fact that this Tuesday night, Nature Boy Ric Flair will be coming to Portland, Oregon, will be defending the world's heavyweight title. And of course, he would like to have Mr. Windham come out there, defend the U.S. title, and we're negotiating on a date somewhere in the near future. But of course, last Saturday, Philadelphia was very interesting day for me. And I know Mr. Cornette is out here gloating, but Mr. Cornette, I want to remind you that I still handle the affairs of the World Heavyweight Champion and the United States Heavyweight Champion, which is a feat in and of itself. And the only thing that you proved in Philadelphia last week was that on that given night, you managed the better team. But you see, Mr. Cornette, just as I've had to do all along, now you must face the test of time, because now the Fantastics and the Sheepherders and the Superpowers, Dusty Rhodes, Nikita Koloff, or whatever the combination has to be, the Road Warriors are going to be breathing down your neck, and you've got to face that test of time. Then we'll see how really good the Midnight Express are. But what you did do was cause me considerable embarrassment in Philadelphia. Mr. Cornette, believe me, the Four Horsemen will always be here. So you can expect some exciting news in the weeks to come. You haven't eliminated the Four Horsemen by any stretch of the imagination. You did cause me some embarrassment, and before I come back to Philadelphia and face those fans, I will have to redeem myself. And Mr. Cornette, it could very well be at your expense. Now, Mr. Windham, I don't know if Sting's been sitting back watching all this or not. I'm sure he has with considerable interest.
He's got his ex-football player buddy with him. You know, I'll tell you what, Sting, you're the only man around here that has to carry around a bodyguard with you. You seem to think that if you carry around an ex-pro football player, that your troubles are going to be over. Let me tell you what, there's a lot of ex-football players out there. Lex Luger's one, he can't seem to get the job done. They're all over the place. Ex-football players are a dime a dozen. John Ayers, if you think you're going to step into the ring and have a hand in me losing the United States Heavyweight Championship, you better think again, pal, because it's not going to happen. I will handle you at a later date. But Sting, as I said before, John Ayers isn't going to get it done for you, pal. It's amazing to me how you can maintain any kind of fan backing having somebody like that in your corner. An ex-washed-up football player. Let me tell you what, pal, this is what it's all about. And if you can't do it by yourself, it's not going to get done.
All right, they talk about the Stinger. He's coming up next. We're going to see him in action and talk to him, too, right after this.
Thank you.
point out that Barry Windham has never had a stiffer challenge from this man right here. His name is Sting, and he is the number one contender to the U.S. Heavyweight title.
You know, Tony, before we get any farther along in this match, we do want to send a very hearty goodwill wishes. I got trying to say his best wishes.
You're doing good.
And,
you're doing well.
Jimmy Garvin. I'm thinking about Jimmy Garvin sitting at home right now watching the program. Jimmy, we know you're watching the program. We hope that you're getting better, Jimmy Garvin, home of convalescing fans. And the doctor said that earlier in his career, a break, an injury of this nature would be a little bit easier to heal. But at this point in time in Jimmy's career, it's a touch-and-go situation. So on behalf of everybody here at the NWA, of course, we want to wish speedy recovery to Jimmy Garvin. Our best wishes, of course, to the lovely Precious, who's having to endure all this agony that Kevin Sullivan and people have perpetrated.
Speaking of agony, what about grabbing a guy by the nose and then taking the right hand and yanking it off?
Well, he's certainly an unorthodox and a bizarre individual. Flying through the air, there's a stinger splash, Max MacGyver. He's planted pretty much there in the corner now, the Scorpion Deathlock. And remember, fans, the Stinger looking for an opportunity to become the United States Heavyweight Champion. And somewhere, sometime, and it could be in your arena, but somewhere, you've got to believe that this man will be an NWA champion, and he's going to become that champion for the very first time. I got a feeling that we're hours away from that happening.
And we're about 24 hours away, 6:05 Eastern Time tomorrow night, NWA main event right here on Superstation TBS. Right now in the ring, the one and only David Crockett with Sting. What?
All right, ladies and gentlemen, here he is, the Stinger. Hey, Stinger, what's this about a bodyguard? You need a bodyguard.
Well, he's talking bodyguard. I don't know where he gets that anyway. I never asked John Ayers to come to ringside for me. I didn't ask him to jump in a ring and help me either. Just so happens when you got James J. Dillon with a shoe or whatever it might be jumping in the ring, it just so happened that John Ayers happened to be ringside with me, and he took my side. Fair's fair, right, David?
That's right. Well, the fans take your side.
Well, some of them do, some of them don't, but that's okay with me. You know, I got so many things on my mind right now. One of them is this haircut thing. Rossi was talking to me about it earlier. He says something about Brian Bosworth.
Hey, listen.
And my haircut, yeah. Me being a superior athlete. Well,
we got to go.
He's a great athlete. Well, let's just leave it like this then. Ow!
Ray!
It really ticks me off when I don't have time to talk to everybody out there.